so let's talk about quantum computing. Frankly speaking, the topic of our discussion is really level hard. So, but maybe let's start from a little bit basic level. And first question to Robert. Robert, what are quantum computers, and should we be afraid of their potential?
Okay, now?
Teraz jest w porządku.
Thanks. So the main idea of quantum computing came in 60s and 70s. There were some theoretical works published then. And in the middle of 2000s were the first implementations of quantum computing. And in general, the quantum computers are the devices that allow us to perform very large scale calculations. But they are distinguished from, let's say, laptops, desktops, and the technology we are using every day, that they are not able to perform every operation we want. It's not possible to run, for example, games or Word or Excel or such applications. They are used for calculations on large numbers or very complex simulations.
Thank you very much. Ian, maybe let's talk about some future. Maybe let's dream. And question to you. Are we all going to have quantum computer on our desk?
Yeah, so yeah, I've heard people talk about quantum smartphones and quantum watches, but no, that's just not going to happen. What seems likely, and just to remind people that quantum computing, currently we're very much in the research and discovery phase, so we're not really even at the, you know, the engineering is very much about discovery and research. But from what we understand, quantum computers are, as Robert intimated, good at very specific things. So it seems highly likely that they will be used to supplement or used in conjunction with the classical computers that we know today. So they will be used for specific tasks, and it's likely that we'll actually access them through you know, a cloud service. So that seems to be the most realistic way that you know, whether it's universities or industry will access the and harness the power of these quantum computers.
Thank you very much. But could you show us some good implications of quantum computing, not only in cybersecurity, but maybe all in other areas? In which areas you would show us some good implications?
Sure. So because of their ability to process very complex problems, it seems likely that they'll be of particular interest in things like drug discovery, in molecular modeling, in machine identity, and you know, just solving really hard problems. And that's why scientists are really interested, because those kind of difficult kind of modeling, you know, how to make catalysts more effective, those kind of challenges where we're really struggling with today's technology, it seems that quantum computers could certainly help in those types of situations.
Thank you very much. So if we know what is a quantum computers, if we know what is the future of our desks and cloud and quantum computers on our desk, so maybe let's talk about some details. So about timeline for developing quantum computers, and what is their impact on modern cryptography, because in our topic we have the issue of cryptography. Ian?
Yep. Robert, of course, if you...
Well, of course, because like Ian said, because of the ability to make very big calculations, quantum computers will be able to crack, simply to crack modern cryptography, asymmetric cryptography especially. Well, to simplify, the modern cryptography like RSA and elliptic curves, they are based on mathematical complexity that is beyond reach of computers that we are using today. With quantum computers, with their ability, when they reach the ability, of course, it will take several years still, they will be able probably to crack the algorithms we are using today. And there are estimates that around 2027, quantum computers may reach the potential to crack the RSA with 2,000 bits, that I think is the most commonly used today. But of course, there are ways that we can protect from them, like having longer keys. But even with longer keys, there are some drawbacks. The algorithms work, there is less efficiency today. But still, in a few years' perspective, the quantum computers will be even more powerful, and they will crack them again.
Well, great, thanks. But what solutions, implementations, processes will be mostly impacted, Ian, in this area?
Yeah, Robert really covered that. Just, you know, it's going back is to the mid-90s, a gentleman called Peter Shor, he really studied the impact on the large prime numbers, which are the basis for today's asymmetric cryptography, and he really identified that these algorithms were at risk when basically the quantum computers can factorize these very large prime numbers in seconds, where today it's decades. So that is the big kind of area of concern. And, you know, some of the threats in the cybersecurity space are, data sets which are encrypted now, but there is a concern that maybe some state actors are actually capturing that data and storing it with the intent to decrypt it once quantum computers are sufficiently able to crack them. So that is a real risk. But yeah, I mean, essentially the fabric of the internet is underpinned by SSL transactions. It uses asymmetric algorithms. So really the entire fabric of the internet and, the secure purchases we make on the internet today, all of that will need to be refactored with algorithms which are resistant to such attacks from quantum computers.
Well, great, thanks. Robert, what countermeasures are on way?
Well, the future is not so grim as you may imagine from what I said previously. There is work going on to prevent this quantum computing threat. And there are, let's say, the main two ways you can countermeasure this. The first way is being made right now by the American National Institution for Standards and Technology, NIST. And they started in 2016, 2017, program of developing new post-quantum algorithms. So the new cryptographic algorithms that will be secure enough, they will work on different mathematical principles that they will be not able to be cracked by quantum computing. And what's interesting, NIST proposed to distinguish, for example, algorithms that will be used in signatures and encryption. Because today we are using the same algorithms, the same implementations of cryptography, in asymmetric cryptography, of course, for signatures and encryption. During this competition, there will be proposed two sets of algorithms. And for example, The curious thing is that one of the algorithms, it's supposed to be cracked. It's the Rainbow algorithms. It's not yet official information on the NIST web pages, but I think it shows that the work done there is done in a good way, because the main goal is to verify if the proposed algorithms are safe, and not safe today, but safe in a very, very long time. No, the RSA and elliptic curves are used for like 40 years or more. The AS, the standard for symmetric cryptography, was completed in, I think, around 2001, something like this. So again, it's 20 years and it's still considered to be safe for another 10 or 20 years. So the work which is being done then there, it will really impact our solutions in very, very long term. And the other way we can countermeasure the quantum computing is going crypto agile. It's the mindset and thinking about cryptography in organizations that will allow us to switch between different algorithms according to our needs. For example, when we will need no algorithms for archiving documents, we can use algorithms with longer key lengths, which are less with less performance. But for example, for protection like SSL and streaming, we can use faster algorithms, which will be less consuming of resources. So, and also in crypto agility, we need to focus on selecting places when we have cryptography implemented. We need to try to change our implementations so they will be able to very, very fast change the algorithms.
Yeah, just to add to that as well, Robert. So the RSA, which we have used for the last 20 years, it was a really adaptable algorithm. And that's why it's been used in so many places in our IT infrastructure. What we've discovered with the NIST competition is that probably we will have a toolkit of algorithms. So it won't just be a case of RSA and put it everywhere. With these post-quantum safe algorithms, we will have this toolkit, and you'll need to choose the best, the right algorithm for the job. So, and because of that, there is going to organizations will need to prepare, will need to investigate, and really start to plan for this, because it won't just be. Whilst crypto agility is good, there will be experimentation required as well to help that process.
Thank you very much. And I have two questions to both of you. First, more general. In your opinion, when I'm listening, you know, do you think that market, business, general, are ready for quantum computing? Is there on the market enough knowledge about the future of cloud impact of quantum computing, or there is not enough knowledge and market is not ready for this future?
Hey, I mean, my opinion that there is quite a lot of hype in terms of quantum computing, and you know, every week you hear about a new breakthrough. There is a huge amount, I mean, billions of dollars investment going into quantum computing at the moment. So really, you know, that is gaining a lot of interest. And I mean, I work for Entrust, and I know that our chief executive, he'd obviously read some articles, and he said, I want to be briefed on this. And I think that's a really good thing, and really it's the type of topic that really should be getting discussed at board level. And for those that go back far enough and remember Y2K, And that challenge, which faced, you know, for many industries, that was a big challenge. Also moving from SHA-1 to SHA-2 hash, again, it was fairly invasive and needed lots of preparation. So the recommendation for organizations, and indeed we with Entrust, we recommend to do the crypto inventory, to investigate, you know, where do you use digital certificates, how are they comprised, build an inventory and start planning for that crypto agility, so that when we start to see these NIST algorithms become approved, we can start to test with them and eventually, you know, to introduce them into our production environments. But that can be a long cycle. That can be, you know, that can be 6 years, 8 years, 10 years for organizations. So be aware that this is coming. And actually, I was in conversation with a leading academic in quantum, Mikhail Mosca, and he actually said, make this problem a life cycle management problem instead of a crisis problem. So absolutely, plan is going to come and be ready for it.
Robert, would you like to add something?
Well, I think there are, let's say, two sides of this coin. One is that the quantum computing, I think, is still a bit of a buzzword in, let's say, the mainstream media. And the other side is that on the back office of the trust services, for example, and the security, cybersecurity, it comes to our minds that the threat is becoming real and we really need to do something about it. And for example, in ASECO, we started testing of quantum algorithms. We are preparing for crypto agility as well. So there are some companies that has already begun the work around this. But I think it's really important to distinguish this between something that is in mass media, the quantum computing, I think we saw it a few days ago or today it was, that the Ministry of Defense in UK is buying a quantum computing, but in what applications it will be used, how it will be used, only I think some hardcore and fixed people will realize how can they use it.
Yeah, maybe that's one thing we haven't explained, but the current state of quantum computers, that as I mentioned, they're still very much in that discovery phase. And it's almost like, you know, we're flying jets now, but think of the Wright brothers, you know, 120 years ago. You know, that's kind of where we're at with quantum computing. It's still got some way to go, but predicting how long that will take, it might be 5 years when we make those big breakthroughs. It could be 10 years, it could be 15. But because of that uncertainty, that's why we should be taking attention of it now.
And to give you another example, like today there are quantum computers that use around 100, 120 qubits. IBM, I think, they are telling that they will have running 1,000 qubit computer next year. But to efficiently crack RSA or elliptic curves, you will need between 2,000 and 3,000 qubits. So, and the complexity of the building of quantum computer grows, I think, a lot, between 1,000, 2,000, and 3,000 qubits.
Thank you very much. And last question to you, and please short answers. In technology, from time to time, we have different topics which are absolutely hot on the market, and everybody would like to discuss about some issues. And we can say that, for example, blockchain was a hot topic for whole industry. And what do you think? Maybe quantum computing will be hotter topic than blockchain in future?
That's certainly a possibility there. I suppose blockchain is interesting, you know, because of the cryptocurrencies. Interestingly, blockchain cryptocurrencies are built using asymmetric cryptography. So, in fact, those ledgers, those blockchains are going to have the same problems as every other part of the IT industry. They will need to evolve and embrace the new post-quantum algorithms. But yeah, so there's challenges definitely ahead.
Robert?
Well, like I said, I think right now the quantum computers and quantum cryptography is more like a buzzword. But in time, because of the ability to have more impact on our everyday life than blockchain, I think blockchain is still focused more on IT geeks still, and it's still looking for some solid implementations beyond cryptocurrencies. But the quantum computers, because of the ability to influence our everyday lives, like Ian said, by having new drugs, having new materials, and so on and so on, they will be more influential and they will go more to everyday life.
Great, thank you very much. Unfortunately, our time has ended, so thank you very much for our discussion.